Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim. Walamma balagha ashuddahu ataynahu hukman wa ilma wa kadhalika najzil muhsinin. Rabbi shrahli sadri wa yassir li amri wa ahlul 'uqdatam min lisani yafqahu qawli. Alhamdulillah wa salatu wa salamu ala rasulillah wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Amma ba'd. Once again everybody, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuh. Today, we try to discuss ayah number 22 of Surah Yusuf. In the last ayah, as far as the chronology of the story is concerned, Yusuf alayhi salam has moved away from his home. He's also now out of the process by which he was being traded off as a slave. And now he's ended up in his new home where this minister from Egypt has bought him and has introduced him to his wife. Allah then describes the plan he had for him, and this was part of the strategic divine design for him to be in this house, to be exposed to all kinds of knowledge, and this was Allah overseeing everything that happens with him, and Allah himself decides what happens with people. Wallahu ghalibun ala amrihi walakinna akthara an-nasi la ya'lamun. Now that's one major event in the story. Now there's going to be a life that he has there for a number of years. And then that life comes to an end basically with the next incident. And that next incident is in ayah number 23. So the life in Egypt started, the basic life in the minister's house started in ayah number 21. And it basically comes to an abrupt halt in ayah number 23 onwards. That's the scene that led to his expulsion from that house and him ending up in jail. But in between these two scenes, which is many years in the making, there's only one ayah, ayah number 22, what we're reading today. In this ayah, instead of describing a number of events that happened that led to this eventual, disaster, Allah is only going to tell us something about Yusuf alayhi salam as if for all those years, the only thing you need to know is the following. So this one statement kind of represents the most significant development of all of those years. And what is that development? وَلَمَّا بَلَغَ أَشُدَّهُ آتَيْنَاهُ حُكْمًا وَعِلْمًا وَكَذَلِكَ نَجْزِي الْمُحْسِنِينَ. And when he reached, you can argue the translation can be when he reached his mature age. But we'll come back to that phrase and dig into it a little bit more in a bit. But for now, I'll give you a brief translation. So when he reached his mature age, أَتَيْنَاهُ حُكْمًا وَعِلْمًا, we granted him wisdom and knowledge. وَكَذَلِكَ نَجْزِي الْمُحْسِنِينَ, and that is how we compensate, or that's how we reward those who excel. So That's all Allah says. For all those years in between, from being brought as a slave to the scandalous event, this is the only thing that he mentions in between. So now let's dig into it a little bit. The first thing to note here is he's been there long enough now to the point where he reaches adulthood. Balagha ashuddahu is the generic Arabic phrase for reaching the adult years or the strongest physical years of your life. That's balagha ashuddahu. There are different kinds of opinions that are floated about in classical tafsir. Nothing is definitive because it doesn't come from either clear linguistic evidence, nor does it come from explicit evidence from the Quran or the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Nothing explicit anyway. So there are opinions about what does this age mean to reach ashud. Some say it's 40 or it's between 35 and 40. Imam Razi went on to describe, these stages in life. He, in his commentary on this ayah, was actually pretty poetic. He described human life like the moon and the phases it goes through in the course of a month. So it's barely visible and very weak, and it gets to its mature full strength, and then is only declined from there, and the decline is slow and slow and slow until there's virtually nothing left. And that's human life. The span, the physical span of human life, he compared it to the lunar month. And in doing so, he said, well, the lunar month is made up of 4 weeks. And you can think of life as in, well, this stage of life, when a child is from 1 year old to 7 year old, then he is basically in week one. So 7 years is like 7 days for him. So, and he describes that. That's the first week of life. And then, which is the first 7 days of life, seven years of life. Then, 8 to 14 is the next. And then 15 to 21 is the next. And then 21, 22 to 28 is the next. And then he described the final week. He actually has a fifth week, funny enough, in his list. And the fifth week is full maturity, 28 onwards. That's what he describes, the age of full maturity. Meaning, and as I'll say, the maturity, not just physically speaking, but in multiple ways. And where do we get this multiple ways from? And what does it mean instead of Allah saying, when he became a young man? He could have just said that, right? But he's using this particular phrase, which is used in the Quran often for people coming of age, or coming to the age where they are held accountable for their actions, or when they are mature enough to live life as an independent adult, right? Surah Al-Ahqaf, for example, not the only place, but another place that has this phrase, حَتَّى إِذَا بَلَغَ أَشُدَّهُ وَبَلَغَ أَرْبَعِينَ سَنَةً. Right, so in Allah describes, actually let me read the whole ayah to you. وَوَصَّيْنَا الْإِنسَانَ بِوَالِدَيْهِ إِحْسَانًا. We counseled the human being regarding both of his parents to try to do their very best. And then he says, حَمَلَتْهُ أُمُّهُ كُرْهًا وَوَضَعَتْهُ كُرْهًا. That his mother carried him with a great deal of difficulty, then delivered him with a great deal of difficulty. Okay, وَحَمْلُهُ وَفِصَالُهُ ثَلَاثُونَ شَهْرًا. And then she carried him and fed him, and all of that went on for 30 months, up to 30 months. Then she says, "Hatta idha balagha ashuddahu." Then he says, then this baby eventually got to the point where they reached adulthood. This is the same phrase, they reached his most mature age. And then he says, "Wabalagha arba'ina sana." And then he reached 40 years, So some say, look, reached mature age and 40 years came together, so they must mean the same thing. But actually, everything in the ayah is one stage, then the next stage, then the next stage, then the next stage. So, balagha ashuddahu is a separate stage. The age of 40 is a separate stage. Just like all the previous were separate stages. There was him, the child in the belly, then the child being delivered, then the child being fed, and then balagha ashuddahu, and then arba'ina sana. So, that's actually a more logical way of looking at it. But anyway, as the judge and others also said that this could be set the age of 17 and onwards, or late teen years, when a child has reached the emotional development also. Now, but let's talk about balagha means to reach. That's an easy word. But what is this? The word ashuddahu. What does that mean? Ashuddahu is the most compelling argument for it is that it is a plural. The word ashud is a plural. And those of you that are interested in sarf, it's on the wazan of af'ul. So ashdud becomes ashud, like ni'matun becomes an'um. The same way shiddatun would become ashdud, and that would turn into ashud, which would mean, if shidda is intensity or strength, or some say it comes from shadd, like shadda in tajweed, right? Shadd actually means to tie something tight, fashuddul wathaq, for example, in the Quran. So it's either to be to have an extreme, or to some extreme difficulty. This is an adjective that's used in the Quran for punishments, for example, adabun shadid, extreme or severe or extreme punishment, right? So that word, then in its plural form, intensities, many maturities, many extremes. What that means is a person becomes, they're a child, their brain works, but it hasn't reached its extreme capacity, its full capacity. They have emotions, but their emotions can turn into tantrums and they don't quite know how to control them yet, or they don't really have full grasp of what they're feeling or the consequences of their emotions. They get to a point where they understand how those emotions work. So from an intellectual level, from a spiritual level, from an emotional level, from a physical level, in all of those he's reached extremes. And that's why the plural is important. So when he reached his most intense phase of life, when it comes to all of them. It can also mean that there's a certain age when everything comes to fruition, meaning our emotions, our physical body, our intellectual capacity, our abilities, all of them come to fruition, which can be a pretty extreme age, because now we're coming out of childhood into adulthood, and it's a new kind of freedom. I can do whatever I want, right? So it's this new independence that comes, and it can be a pretty extreme age also, because it's like you're really redefining yourself. You're finding yourself anew, right? And a lot of us look back at our early years and we remember that when we came to the age coming out of adolescence and coming out of the early teen years into early adulthood and stepping into adulthood was some of the more rebellious years of our life, right? Or some of the most difficult. We acted in ways we look back like, why was I acting so crazy? Like, I did things I never imagined I would do. And then we see our kids doing those things and we're like, oh yeah, been there, I did that. Right, so balagha ashuddahu is maybe a reference to that too. In the Quran, Allah will even describe that if you have orphans and you're taking care of them and you're responsible to manage their finances because they're too little to manage their own finances. The inheritance came, but a 4-year-old can't manage his inheritance. So فَإِنْ عَنَسْتُمْ مِنْهُمْ رُشْدًا فَدْفَعُوا إِلَيْهِمْ أَمْوَالَهُمْ. Allah didn't use بَلَغَ أَشُدَّهُ there. He said, if you find in them that they're upright enough, then you hand them over. Like Allah didn't put a legal age. At this age, hand over the financial responsibilities to a young man or young woman. Instead, He said, when you find uprightness, why? Because that can be relative. It could be some kids are 25 years old, but they still have a brain of a 14-year-old. And they have the maturity of a 10-year-old. That can happen. Right, but if you find the right kind of maturity, then you pass the financial responsibility on. In the case of Yusuf alayhi salam, it does seem from the movement of the story, it does seem that now he's reached the age where he's a young man and he's sort of proven himself, and he's at the service of the owner of the house, and he is, if we accept the biblical account, which there's no reason not to, because it does seem to correspond with the Quran's account. That he is in charge of the house in many ways. He's taken up pretty much all of its responsibilities. Allah says, when he reached that age, آتَيْنَاهُ حُكْمًا. We granted him hukm. So now, there's going to be a discussion among Mufassirun about what this hukm means. I've translated it, when I gave you my brief translation, I said it means wisdom, right? And actually, you have to look at both words together. We gave him wisdom, وَعِلْمًا, and knowledge. So he reaches this age, and now Allah says He's given him wisdom and knowledge. So there are lots of discussions about what this could mean. And a very common interpretation is that hukm here means that Allah made him a prophet. So when he reached a certain age, Allah made him a prophet. Then there's counter arguments to that, because Allah has already revealed to him when he is going inside the well, you will be informing them of this. If Allah is giving him revelation at that age, he's already a prophet. He's receiving that information. Before that, he's got a revealed dream that comes to be true. So there could be argument about when he became a prophet, which then led to a separate technical kind of aqidah discussion. At what age can we consider a person to become a prophet? Is this the exception? Is this the norm? You know, because our conventional view is prophets become prophets at the age of 40. But then what happens with Jesus? Right, he's speaking as a baby. And then you've got the story of John, of Yahya alayhi salam, in the Quran, وَآتَيْنَاهُ الْحُكْمَ, same word, sabiyya. We gave him wisdom as a boy. That's what the Quran says about Yahya alayhi salam. So there are these other cases too. Then, Imam Alusi went on to say, and some people couldn't quite grasp that a young child could have prophethood. So therefore they said he must not have been a prophet at all. And that's absolutely false. So he refutes that. And of course, the ijma', nobody accepts that view. Yusuf alayhi salam is a prophet of Allah. And there's overwhelming evidence to that. So there's no way to argue that case. But there's another side to this. So they say, okay, well, he gave him wisdom and then knowledge. But if wisdom means revelation, well, knowledge is also revelation. So what's the difference? So then they tried to say, well, knowledge, generally, prophethood is wisdom. And then the special knowledge of interpreting dreams or interpreting speech, that is the special knowledge on top. So it's like the overwhelming thing is hukum. And then ilm is on top of that, like the icing on the cake, or the very special part of it. Because in Arabic, when you say and, A and B, it doesn't have to mean that A is separate from B. It could also mean that A is, generally speaking, and within A, the most special part is B. Right? So you can do that. You can take a part of A and mention it after the word and. Okay? So that's the argument that's being made also. But Imam Fakhruddin al-Razi said something that kind of made me, it put my mind at ease, because I wasn't thinking along those lines at all. Even though, yes, Allah has made him a prophet. But if we reduce the meaning, and hukm does come in the meaning of prophecy in the Quran, that's true too. But the problem is, it doesn't just come in the meaning of prophecy. And you have to look at the terminology in the Quran sometimes case by case, and not say, well, he meant this by this same word, he meant it over here as such, so it must mean the same thing here. It doesn't actually work always that way, because there are wujuh. In the Quran, there are multiple facets of words, right? For example, the word Rabb is master of the worlds, is Allah, right? But in this surah, there's going to be the word Rabb used for the master of the house too. It's going to be used. The word Malik is used in Surah An-Nas for Malik al-Nas, right? It's for Allah, the king of people. But in this surah, Fidin al-Malik is going to be the king of Egypt. So you could have the same word, but it doesn't have to refer to the same thing. That can happen. And similarly, deen, when we think of deen, we think of religion. لَكُمْ دِينُكُمْ وَلِيَ دِينَ وَرَأَيْتَ النَّاسَ يَدْخُلُونَ فِي دِينِ اللَّهِ أَفْوَجًا. But in this surah, you're going to find فِي دِينِ الْمَلِكِ in the, not the, because he couldn't hold on to Benjamin or Binyamin in the palace according to the deen of the king. The king didn't have a religious problem with keeping Benjamin. There was a problem with the law. Like, the king has a certain law, and no one gets to stay in the castle or in government grounds unless they're authorized. So that was, the word deen was being used in the meaning of a constitution rather than religion, right? So what I'm trying to get at is not just the unique vocabulary of the surah, but generally speaking, words in the Quran, because they mean one thing in one context, does not mean that that is the only meaning you will find them in every context. They can occur in different meanings. And if this is a little bit hard to grasp, how can Quran do that? Well, it even happens in language. It's a natural phenomenon of language, in any language. So for example, a word like screen, right? The word screen, simple enough, everybody here, or all of you that are watching, I think know the word screen. The word screen can mean itself, it can mean its opposite. The word screen could mean a TV screen, a projector screen. It could mean the screen on a phone. It could mean a screen like that. Maybe you're watching me on a screen right now if you're watching live. You're watching me on a screen. But if I put a screen between the adult section of the audience and the children's section of the audience, they're behind a screen, right? So then the screen is not something that helps you see, but the screen becomes something that blocks your view, right? Oh, there's a screen over here. Or we're screening some content. You know what that means? We're blocking some content. We're not letting it be seen. You're screening some of the news event. You're screening some of the transcript, etc. That means you're blocking it out. So it's the same word, but in different contexts, it can mean different things. So that's kind of the background. Anyway, let me get to what Imam Fakhruddin al-Razi said, which I think is pretty cool about this. He said that you can think of wisdom as practical knowledge acquired from, or the right choice made in the right circumstances. So for example, somebody never went to school. I'm going to give you a worldly, he didn't give this example. I'm giving you the example to explain Razi's concept. Somebody never went to school, but they got a job working at a mechanic shop, yeah? And they work with the mechanic, they fix cars from like the age of like 16, 17, they're fixing cars. Now they never went to mechanic school. They've never, studied engineering or whatever. But since the guy's been working in the mechanic shop for 10 years now, and he's 26 years old, he's got 26 or 10 years of experience fixing cars. He may not know all the terms. He may not know all the technicalities. He may not even be able to read a mechanic textbook. But he knows cars better than some of the guys that graduate from that school. You understand? So his knowledge was based on actual experiential learning. So his experience, his hands-on experience came first, and that hands-on experience kept giving him more and more knowledge, right? So that's hikmah. Hikmah is, or hukum, he argues, is knowledge acquired through experience or hands-on. So it's practical knowledge. By working, putting yourself to work, like for example, somebody doesn't know how to cook, yeah? And they make a disastrous whatever they make. They can't even tell what they made. But 5 years later, after lots of experimentation, they're pretty good at cooking. But they never took a cooking class. They just trial and error, and they got better and better at it, yeah? So that's kind of hukum, meaning knowledge that is built with experience. The other side is people that study something theoretically and then try to bring it to the world of the practical, right? So you go to school, you learn something theoretically, and now you want to come on the practical side and apply it. Right? So there's two different ways of, knowledge. So he's saying that hukum is more like the first case. The first case being where you have practical knowledge, and that practical knowledge builds your knowledge. Your practical application builds your knowledge. Your experience is building your knowledge. Basically, real life knowledge. Yeah. On the flip side, you've got somebody who is studying the subject, but they've never had the hands-on experience, and they're going to get to the hands-on experience later, right? And so what he's comparing then, he's saying, Allah gave Yusuf alayhi salam the hands-on knowledge first, hukman. So that's his way of looking at it. And why? Because obviously Yusuf alayhi salam is not in a school. He's not in a seminary. He's not studying or learning. He's actually a servant. And he's not studying politics in a class. He's in the political environment. He's not learning what governors do in a book that talks about governors and governance. He's in the room with the governor. So he's in the actual practical classroom. He's not learning about how, in a sociology class, how slaves would, function with each other or communicate with each other. He's sitting and having lunch with them. So he's actually having the lived experience of learning, and from it he's building that knowledge. That's hukman, and on the other side is ilman. And he says Imam Razi says there are two roads to learning, and Allah gave him this road, meaning the practical first, and then the lessons that he draws from that become his knowledge base. Right? This is also an interesting comment on what we think of as educated. Because, you know, today the world, especially after the Industrial Revolution, the world started standardizing education for the purpose of more skilled labor, right? So you have to have certain certifications, or, you know, an associate's degree, a high school diploma, an associate's degree, a bachelor's degree, a master's degree, a PhD, etc. These labels come next to you that certify what you know, right? They certify what you know. And if you don't have a degree, then you don't really, you're considered uneducated, right? So you don't have knowledge, if you will. But the world, historically speaking, didn't work this way. The world worked on, actually most of the world, most people in the world, learned by experience. And some had the privilege of, you know, theoretical knowledge and eventually practical knowledge. The other crazy thing is sometimes you have, you know, people pay top dollar now to go to schools and colleges and all of that. And in many cases, they go and receive a theoretical education in the subject. And when they come into the industry, they find that almost all of what they learned about the work they're going to do doesn't apply in the real world. It's the theory is so going somewhere else, and the practice is somewhere else. But it still looks good on the resume that I have a degree that got me the job. So the degree became more a reason to get the job, but not a reason to do the job. Right? Because when you got to the job, you had to relearn. And well, that's not what they said in class. Yeah, this ain't class. This is real life, you know? And then you start wondering, why did I take all these classes? Why did I learn all this stuff? I thought this is going to prepare me for the real world. So now it's become a crazy fake economy on its own, where people are getting a degree not for the skill, the actual knowledge that it gives, but just for the paper that it gives, the sticker that it gives at the end that you can use on a resume, even though when you get into the work environment, it's not going to actually, much of it is not going to apply. And that's unfortunately the case in many situations. And that speaks also to the quality of education. If an education is going to be provided, you know, you have to be savvy enough to know, is this just an education for me to get a degree? Or is the kind of education this institution is providing worth, actually in line with the industry I plan on going into, right? And so, but from the flip side, if somebody said, you know, I might take these courses or whatever, and this actually happened with me on a practical side, when I was thinking about this ayah, when I was going to college, I was studying computer information systems, yeah, and network security and some of these things early on. And then I got a job at a tech firm where they had to deal with network security issues. And when I'm at work, we're doing something completely different from what we're discussing at work. And I'd bring that to the attention of my professor and say, that's not what we do at work. We do this, this, and this. Yeah, that's later on. That's not, but when does this apply? Well, you probably won't ever see this in application. Like, why am I taking this course? Why are we doing this? Because if I'm not going to see it, why are we learning it? So we should be learning things that we're actually going to be putting to use, right? So anyway, that's hukman and then ilman in his point of view. But I'll add another dimension. And one way to look at this ayah is it's specific to Yusuf alayhi salam. This is probably the most important part of today's conversation. Allah gave him wisdom by putting him in different scenarios, practical knowledge. And on top of that, Allah granted him knowledge. And this could also mean Allah revealed knowledge on top of that to him. Or Allah taught him in unconventional ways. And so you've got this wisdom and knowledge dichotomy. But then Allah ends this ayah in a very interesting way. He says, and that is how, وَكَذَٰلِكَ نَجْزِ الْمُحْسِنِينَ. That is how we compensate those who excel. Now that last part kind of opens the door, because if you're saying that wisdom and knowledge here refers to prophethood, yeah, if you say that here it refers to prophethood, the problem becomes, Allah says at the end, not, and that is how we rewarded him. He said, that is how we reward those who excel. That means anybody who excels will be rewarded with prophethood? Because he says, this is the reward of doing your best, of excelling. Wisdom and knowledge is a reward for doing your best. So that means that this is referring to something other than prophethood. Okay, the ihsan, to excel, to do your best, is the reward for that is wisdom and knowledge. But then came another challenge. Here's a really interesting challenge. If someone is doing their best, if they are excelling, I would imagine they have wisdom and knowledge. That's why they are what? Excelling. But the ayah says, those who excel, I reward them with wisdom and knowledge. It's kind of like a chicken and egg situation now. Because how could I excel without wisdom and knowledge? And Allah says, well, once you excel, I'll give you wisdom and knowledge. Right? So how do we reconcile those two things? You see, if you don't have, everybody has a little bit of wisdom, a little bit of knowledge. And let's go back and redefine wisdom and knowledge in the broadest terms. Wisdom actually means, please understand this, this is Dr. Fadl Salih Hassami did a brilliant job explaining hikmah, or hukm also. Wisdom is the willpower and the ability to make the right choice. Wisdom is the willpower and the ability to make the right choice based on the right. If you know something to be right, you're going to do it. Now the problem is, a lot of people know something to be right, but they do the wrong thing anyway. Because there are other factors at play. Actually, in classical tafsir, in discussing this ayah, they also talked about wisdom having the control over your urges, having the control over your emotions. Having hikmah actually comes from hukm, which means governance. And before you can govern anything else, wisdom means you have the power to govern yourself. You have the ability to impose rules on yourself. So you're not in a free-for-all. And which is a really powerful thing in this ayah, because later on, way later on, Allah will describe that Allah will give Yusuf alayhi salam governance. Yes? But before He gives him governmental control over other things and people, Allah has granted him governance and control over himself. That, so once you have mastery over yourself, then you're in a position to make judgments over others. That's a pretty powerful thing to say. It's as if, and by the way, he became a politician eventually, right? Yusuf alayhi salam. Now today, when we think of politicians, obviously we always think of people that have very good self-control and control their temper, control their urges, control their greed. No, they don't. The last thing we associate with people in governance is self-restraint and control. Actually, we think of them as the people the most out of control. The most erratic and the most out of control, we think of people in a position of power. You know, they say the axiom in English is power corrupts, and absolute power corrupts absolutely. That's what it's become now. But here you have, before any of that, he's a servant right now. And Allah has granted him self-control and restraint and the ability to make the right choice when the situation calls for it, because he knows better. Now, and on top of that, he gave him knowledge. Now, this is the height of wisdom. You know, it's going to take me a little while to explain these two terms together, but it's worth it. I think it's worth this discussion. You see, when children are growing up, if they're smart, like some kids are super smart in first grade, second grade, third grade, their minds are like sponges. They can memorize things quickly. They can pick up languages. They can become multilingual very quickly. You know, Allah has created a child's brain is an incredible machine. It's just they absorb so quickly. Languages, behaviors, you know, new sciences, they can pick that stuff up. The thing is, all of that is knowledge. All of that is what? Knowledge. And a kid can become super smart and be an A student, and they're 15, 16 years old, but when it comes to life and making good choices in terms of who should be their friend, or what should they be doing with their spare time, or what kinds of things should they be doing when nobody else is watching, they can make some pretty stupid choices anyway. So when it comes to their intelligence, they're highly intelligent, they're capable of coding, they can make their own app, they can build their own robot, they can do all kinds of crazy things, they're super smart. But when it comes to some other things, they're so dumb. You're like, how are you so smart and so dumb at the same time? I had a Texan friend who told me a term I've never heard before. He said, stupid genius. I love that term. How could you be a stupid genius? You're a genius on one thing, but in certain choices in life, you're so ridiculously stupid. You have kids that are, or young men, young women and young men that are so smart, so intelligent, and they know better than anybody else the dangers of reckless driving, but because they are straight A student, or because they did so well on their exams and graduated or whatever, dad bought them a car. Right? And now they got the car, they're on the highway, nobody's watching, they're doing 95, 100, 105, 110. What a ridiculously stupid thing to do. You're so smart and you're acting so ridiculously. You know what that means? A lot of times, and as we're coming up as human beings, knowledge is actually pretty easy. But wisdom, the ability to make right choices, not so much. Not so much. Knowledge can, because the brain, Allah designed it in a way that it comes easy. But good choices, yeah, we make some pretty bad choices as we're growing up. And we need a lot of guidance, and we need to be handled with care so we cannot make some of those poor choices, right? And the thing is that when you think of old people, people that have lived life, 60, 70, 80 years old, we go to them, literally anywhere in the world, we go to them for wisdom. Why? Because they've lived life, they've made some poor choices when they were younger, they know what the consequences of it are, and so they have a kind of real life knowledge that books cannot give you. So they are people of what? Wisdom, right? So what I'm saying is, youth can be associated with learning, knowledge. And older age is associated with what? Wisdom. Which is kind of in line with Imam Razi's definition too, because as you age, you have more and more practical experience, which has shaped the way you look at life. It's shaped your knowledge. But young people know a lot, but they haven't experienced it, so they think they figured the world out. And you could have, for example, people in the same classroom, and young people have an opinion, and old people just look at them like, I used to think like that. Because this young man knows what they've read, but they haven't seen the world yet. Right? This young woman knows what she studied, but she hasn't experienced life yet. So they don't know. They've got these opinions, but ilm is there, hukm hasn't come yet. Why is that odd in the story of Yusuf? A young man who just comes into adulthood, and instead of Allah saying, and he came into knowledge, which eventually matured into wisdom, what's the first thing that's mentioned? Wisdom. You don't associate a young man with wisdom. You don't associate, wisdom is an old age thing. Making better choices, learning from experience, you know, not repeating a past mistake. These are things, these are, you know, qualities of wisdom. Allah has given him that first, hukman. And what Allah is describing here is Allah has granted that to him. Allah has granted him self-governance. He has given him ability to self-govern. Mufassirun even mentioned that his ability to self-govern and restrain himself was so powerful that, you know, the owner of the house must have noticed. So there are even some narrations attributed to Sahaba that when the man of the house, when he used to go and people used to come to him with political cases or different kinds of situations, he used to leave it to Yusuf, why don't you figure this out? I think you can make a good decision. You have so much self-governance and you can govern over other people too, even as a servant. Atainahu hukman. And then on top of that, Allah gave him knowledge, wa ilman. This also means that in the modern world that we live in, we are, as parents, and even for young people that are watching this, you're concerned with getting yourself a good education. I want to have a good education. And a good education is going to mean a degree, or what subject I'm going to specialize in, and what kind of job I'm going to have. All of that would be under ilm. But before all of that, are we people of hukm? Are we actually people of good choices? A long time ago, I gave a khutbah, it must have been maybe 15 years ago, about the definition of education from a Quran's point of view. And this is actually part of that. And part of that is, the Quran is emphasizing knowledge that makes us better human beings over knowledge that makes us better, you know, more skilled. So theoretical knowledge and labor knowledge and knowledge of farming and knowledge of medicine and knowledge of architecture and knowledge of finance, that knowledge just makes you a better worker. It's a skill, but it may not necessarily make you a better human being. So you can have a PhD in physics that doesn't know how to talk to their neighbor properly. Is that possible? Highly educated, but highly ignorant when dealing with your neighbor. Highly educated in whatever, you're a professor of things, but you don't know how to talk to your parent or your child or your spouse or, you know, family. You don't know how to do basic manners, basic things that make you a decent person. You don't know how to make basic good choices in your life, but highly educated in one way. Because all the emphasis now is on ilm, and none of the emphasis is on hukum. None of it is on hukum. But that doesn't answer that last riddle that I want to leave you guys with. And that is, Allah says, and that's how we compensate those who excel. You see, the axiom, which is not a hadith, but some say it's an athar, It was mentioned in Lucy answering this question. How can someone excel and do their best when they don't have wisdom and knowledge, and wisdom and knowledge will be given to them as a result of them excelling? You see, let's just say I don't know much. I'm going to give you a practical example, because by example, things are easily remembered, yeah? Somebody took shahada. Okay? Somebody took shahada, just became Muslim. They don't know their alif ba, they don't know how to pray, they don't know how to... They can't figure out the direction of the Kaaba, they haven't figured out the right times for the prayer yet. Everything's hard for them. They keep forgetting which foot to enter into the bathroom. Left hand, oh, right hand. Everything is hard. Everything is new. Everything is alien. When people say assalamu alaikum, they say wakalla kamasa kalamallah, because they don't know how to say wa alaikum assalam yet. Everything is difficult. They clearly have no knowledge. And then they look at other people that are so much more knowledgeable than them. They're like dropping Arabic once, like one thing after that. Alhamdulillah, mashallah, inshallah. Things you take for granted. They're looking at them like, that's a lot of sounds. I got to learn all that, you know? And then they open up a copy of the Mus'haf and they see all this Arabic and it starts looking like, you know, alien little creatures that are crawling all over the place, and they're like, how am I going to do this, you know? And then they start taking like a Qaida Nuraniya class or something, and the teacher says alif, they're like alif, ba, that's easy, ba, ta, ta, tha, ha, tha, what, tha, say it, tha, 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 4 hours on tha. Oh, jim was easy. Okay, say ha, like what, ha, you know, over here. I've never done that before. Ha, 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 ha. Every sound is hard. Every word is hard. Every practice is hard. It's so, and they have no knowledge. And they feel so inferior to those who know. But as little as they know so little. They know so little. But they know one thing. They're not going to drink alcohol anymore. They don't know much, but they just know that. So when they go to their cousin's house, and everybody else is non-Muslim, and somebody passes them a beer, like they always passed them a beer, they said, no, God said I can't. Allah said I can't. Who's Allah? God. You know, in the Quran, that's His name, that's the actual name, Allah. He said I can't. Really? So you can't drink? No, I can't. You know, even though they know it's going to make a socially awkward situation in the family, they might get made fun of, and people are drunk, so they're going to be even crazier, right? But they decided to stand by that. You know what they did? They did their best. They didn't know a lot, but whatever they knew, they did their best with that. Yeah? When they did their best with that, Allah's promise in the Quran is that now He will open up the doors of wisdom, which means He will give them the strength to make even better choices in even harder situations. And He will give them sense to do the right thing even more. And then on top of that, Allah will open another door, and the learning that looks so difficult, Allah will make that easy for them. That's not because they're smart, because Allah sends angels from above to make difficulties easy for this person, because they showed Allah that they did their best. وَكَذَلِكَ نَجْزِي الْمُحْسِنِينَ. And that is how we compensate those who do their best. When those... Yusuf alayhi salam is a child, he doesn't know much, but whatever little he knows, he lives by, and Allah opens more doors of wisdom for him and more knowledge for him. Then more doors of wisdom and more knowledge and more doors of wisdom and more knowledge. You prove to Allah that you're taking a step towards Him. You show Him excellence with whatever little you know. And Allah will open more doors. And by the way, this is exactly how someone comes into Islam to begin with. I give you an example of someone who just became Muslim, but even before they were Muslim, they decided to do something right. They decided somewhere in their life, I want to do right by God. I don't know what that means yet, but I do know I shouldn't be lying anymore. I do know I shouldn't be hurting anybody anymore. I do know I need to make some changes. They don't even know anything about revelation or the Quran or the Bible, nothing. But they just made a choice that they want to do good by Allah, by God. And you know what Allah does? Allah opens their mind and gets them to start thinking with wisdom and saying, wait, this 1 and 3 and 3 and 1's not making sense anymore. Wait, this... these idols, my parents are going to the temple, I just don't feel like going anymore. They don't even know Islam yet, but they've got some hikmah now. And because of that hikmah, that wisdom now, they're making better choices and they're stopping themselves from certain choices just because they showed Allah one step. And this is Allah saying, وَالَّذِينَ جَاهَدُوا فِينَا لَنَهْدِيَنَّهُمْ سُبُلَنَا وَإِنَّ اللَّهَ لَمَعَ الْمُحْسِنِينَ. Surah Al-Ankabut at the end, those who struggle towards our path, who struggle in our cause, then Allah will, He says, we will absolutely guide them to multiple pathways that lead to us. And Allah is absolutely with those who do their best. Allah is not asking perfection. Allah is asking for you to do your best. If you can do your best, you can actually be, and I can be part of this ayah. He says, when he reached his mature age, we granted him wisdom and knowledge, and that is how we compensate all those who do their best. That last part can include you. That last part can include me. And then that would mean that Allah will intervene through the heavens. Allah will intervene for you and me to open up doors of wisdom in here and in here. And open up knowledge. And here's the other thing about hukum, wisdom. I keep telling you, it's the willpower to do the right thing, the strength to do the right thing, restraint, good decision making, right? But all of that means you have to have control over what's going on in your heart. Yeah? So hukum actually means someone who has good governance, good control over what their heart allows them to do. They have good restraint on their heart. And so their heart is becoming stronger and stronger in doing the right thing. The you know, whatever you practice more of, that muscle gets stronger. Yeah? If you run a lot, your legs are getting stronger, right? If your heart is feeling something wrong and you keep practicing it, you keep giving into that heart, the urge to do that, the desire to do that, the addiction to do that will get stronger and stronger and stronger. But when you control your heart and do the right thing, then control your heart and do the right thing, and control your heart and do the right thing, your ability to do the right thing becomes stronger. Your ability to stop yourself from the wrong thing becomes stronger. That's hukum. Your governance is making you stronger. But this was a matter of the heart. But when he says knowledge, ilman, ilman is a matter of the mind, right? So it's as if Allah is saying, those who do their best, Allah will give them a strong heart and then open up their minds. Which is actually going back to something I mentioned before. There are two kinds of knowledge being given to Yusuf alayhi salam. A knowledge that is spiritual, that cleanses his heart, and a knowledge of the world, that he's interpreting all kinds of speech. Yeah? So there's spiritual strength, spiritual knowledge, and worldly knowledge. And here also in hukman, you can have spiritual knowledge. And in ilman, you can have worldly knowledge. And he's being put in these situations where he's making the right choice over and over again. Now, the last thing I share with you about the ihsan of Yusuf alayhi salam. I tried to have you, what I'm going to try to do as we navigate this story, it's going to be a little bit difficult, but I'm going to do my best to do it. There's, you know, it's oversimplistic when you read a fairy tale that, you know, there's a good guy and a bad guy. Right? There's a villain and there's a hero, right? And the villain's always bad and the hero's always good, right? But this isn't just a story about, you know, Little Red Riding Hood and the wolf and there's good and there's bad. It's not like that. These are actual human beings. And human beings, his brothers, the minister's wife, the minister, these people, they have good in them and they have bad in them. Human beings, فَأَلْهَمَهَا فُجُورَهَا وَتَقْوَاهَا. We inspired the human being to have the ability to explode into sin and also to protect themselves. We have both urges inside of us. We have opposing forces inside of us, yes? So when we learn about the characters in this story, then one tendency is that we want to see them entirely as bad. Like the brothers of Yusuf are just bad. Or, you know, the minister's wife who's going to come up tomorrow, for example, she's just an evil lady. Look at her. Look at her. What kind of evil haram she did. What she did is haram, and what she did is evil. But clearly, even though Quran is saying eventually she's not all bad because she acknowledges her mistake and repents, and there's something more to her than just this. But the word I'll use is empathy. And empathy is important. What is empathy? Empathy means, fine, people do messed up things, and those are wrong, and they're immoral. But what circumstances made it easier for them to do the wrong thing? What opened the door more wider and wider that the wrong thing became easier and easier and easier? The fact that they stepped into the wrong thing and did the wrong thing is their fault. They're responsible. Absolutely. But are there things that happened around them that they didn't realize are that bad? That they actually made it They put themselves in danger, and then more danger, and then more danger, and then more danger, until they fell into the sin itself, and they fell into the wrong way of thinking, the wrong sets of feelings. Like I'm telling you with Yaqub alayhis-salam's sons, I don't believe the brothers to be evil, actually. I believe them to be broken. I don't believe them to be evil. They could have talked to their father, they could have taken steps that would have been healthier, but they somehow skipped some of those steps, and a bad feeling they had inside of them eventually turned into a toxic way of looking at life, eventually turned into opening doors for evil deeds. If you don't empathize with that, if you don't understand where that came from, then it may be that we may not be at the point where we're ready to kill a Yusuf. We may not be at the level of evil where we're doing what the minister's wife did, but maybe we're on step one and we don't realize it. Maybe we're on step two, and by step 10, that's going to happen. Yeah? If we don't empathize and understand where these steps come from, and what are these steps that people often overlook? They don't realize they're on a trajectory, on a path to doing something very, very bad, or heading in a very bad direction for their own hearts. Then they may only realize it after it's too late, or not even then. Or it may be that they do something heinous, and it's only years later, like the brothers of Yusuf or the minister's wife, years later they're going to realize they did something wrong. So they're going to live in this delusion that they've done nothing wrong. We don't want to be like that. I don't want to be like that. You don't want to be like that. The reason I'm bringing this up now in ayah number 22 is when Yusuf alayhi salam is described as someone who does his very best. Ihsan. The Prophet's definition comes to mind, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. أن تعبد الله كأنك تراه وإن لم تكن تراه فإنه يراك. That you worship Allah and you enslave yourself to Allah as if you can see Allah. And if you can't see Him, which is the fact, you can't see Him, at the very least you're always aware that He is seeing you. He's seeing. That's doing your best. That awareness is actually excellence. That awareness is excellence. And the thing is, any choice we're making, if we just stop and say, I know mom didn't see it, I know dad didn't see it, I know my husband didn't see this, I know my wife didn't see this, I know my siblings didn't see this, I know nobody else saw this, but Allah is watching this. Is it okay? Should I take this step? Or can I justify it to myself? If you honestly ask yourself this question, you can stop yourself in your tracks. The reason it's so remarkable for Yusuf alayhi salam is that he is living in a non-believing environment, in a non-believing household, where he is being entrusted with whatever choice he wants to make. There is no parental or moral supervision. There is no spiritual reinforcement. There is no Islamic school. There is no madrasa. There is no tajweed classes. There's no one teaching him adab. There's no one teaching him not to stay up late at night. There's no one teaching him get up in the morning for fajr. There's no one teaching him anything. He is on his own, so long as he does what the master wanted him to do, the groceries, attend this meeting, write this down, do this or that. So long as he does his work, he is free to do whatever he wants. He is not really under any moral supervision. He may be under labor supervision, but he's not under any spiritual or moral supervision. And yet, he remembers something from the training of his father. It doesn't matter who's watching me or not, Allah is. And I'm going to try to do my best, morally, because you know, there are other slaves there too, and they do messed up things. Why wouldn't they? Why wouldn't they do haram things? They don't have Sharia. They don't have the law of Allah. He's in a completely un-Islamic environment, in a country that doesn't believe in Allah the way we do, where the things that Allah declares haram are not only halal, but they're celebrated, and they happen all the time, and they're all over the place, and he's in the middle of all of that. You could say we are the product of our environment, right? What do you want me to do? I was surrounded by this stuff. That's why I did it. Everybody around me was partying. What do you want me to just like sit there and memorize Surah Al-Baqarah? What did you expect? It's a party school I went to. It's a dormitory, for God's sake. You know what happens in dormitories? Seriously, man. How do you expect me to survive? It's like you're asking me, you threw me in the middle of the ocean with a plank and I'm holding on and it's raining and you tell me don't get wet. Of course I'm going to get affected by my environment. Seriously, this is all I ever known. He could make all those arguments, can't he? He could make every one of those arguments. But Allah is telling us that He excels, meaning it doesn't matter who He sees in front of Him. It doesn't matter who He's surrounded with. He Himself, He finds Himself surrounded in the presence of Allah. A very powerful thing. And that's when Allah gives him strength. He gives him strength to not follow trends. He gives him strength not to follow everybody else. He gives him strength not even to follow the inner thoughts that he has, because he's given him governance over his own heart. He's given him all of that because he chooses to recognize Allah's presence in a society and in a world and in a 24-hour day where no one else around him reinforces the presence of Allah. He's in a completely messed up environment already. People think that he's in a messed up environment when he's going to end up in prison. Freedom can be a different kind of prison. Freedom is its own kind of prison. In a physical prison, you are caged by bars. When you have absolute freedom, you are caged by your own desires. You will follow them wherever they take you. You will follow society wherever it takes you. You will follow trends wherever they take you. We've become so imprisoned by trends that if a new shoe comes out, if a new purse comes out, if a new phone comes out, people are like, my life is meaningless until those shoes are on my feet. How can I show my face? And what worth do I have if I don't have this, the new, you know, iPhone, the new Anna phone, the new Nafs phone? So I could take a selfie, a Nafsi. Nafsi, everybody. Right? We've become so immersed, enslaved in this materialistic environment, in this fake persona environment, that we're actually, we're not free, we're enslaved. Allah frees him. It's ironic. What I'm saying is, he lives as a slave, but in some respects, he's actually the only person in his society that's free. He's the only one that's free. Like even the woman that tries to mess him up, she's enslaved by the sickness of her mind. She's enslaved by them. She's being controlled by them. أَرَأَيْتَ مَنَ اتَّخَذَ إِلَهَهُ هَوَاهُ. Have you seen someone who takes their desires and their feelings and their whims and their emotions and turns them into their God? That's what she lives. And he accepted Allah as his master, so he's freed from every other slavery. That's a very powerful lesson. How do we stay strong in a non-Muslim environment or in a fitna environment? Y'all don't even need an environment anymore. You just need a phone with internet. Why you need an environment? You're like, COVID-19, social distancing, alhamdulillah, we're not in a bad environment. No, you're in probably the same exact bad environment, because social media, it's all there. All the access to all the wrong things is always there. It's always in your face. It's always there. The thing is, and we keep asking the silly question, maybe if we remove ourselves from society and go in some, you know, Islamic environment, then we'll be better off. This is the Islamic environment you need. This. If in here there's an Islamic environment, then the outside environment could be Egypt, and you could be like Yusuf, and you'll be fine. أَتَيْنَهُ حُكْمًا وَعِلْمًا. Notice the great people mentioned in the Quran, prophets or not, are always described to be in a minority. Always. They're always in the minority. Why does Allah describe a believer's heart like a lamp in Surah An-Nur? He describes it like a lamp because a lamp is only purposeful when there's darkness. You don't turn a lamp on during the day. You only turn a lamp on when? When it's night. The believer was destined to be surrounded by darkness, because in that darkness, the only light is supposed to be you. And here you are, the lamp, complaining, I want to go to a place where there's more light. It's too dark here. Bro, you're the lamp. Light it up. Fix this up. Let's become people of ihsan, so Allah will give us stronger hearts, hukman, and He'll give us the right kind of knowledge, because it is only then that we become an impact on the world around us. That's when light spreads. Not from us escaping from darkness, but us becoming the light in the darkness. That's what we have to do for each other. And Yusuf alayhi salam is doing this with the little knowledge that he has as a child, whatever Allah has taught him through Yaqub alayhi salam. And now this environment that he's put in, he is becoming a person of ihsan. وَكَذَلِكَ نَجْزِ الْمُحْسِنِينَ. It's a remarkable, you know, story that teaches us something about, you know, peer pressure. And how irrelevant peer pressure can become because of iman, because of ihsan. And when you turn towards Allah, as I leave you, I tell you, when you and I turn towards Allah, and we try to do this, we become muhsineen, we're going to be the odd ones out. We're going to be the unacceptable ones in society. We're going to be the ones that should be thrown in a jail. Because we're doing the right thing. And it will be so much easier to do the wrong thing and not be cast off. So much easier. First of all, you'll have to conquer yourself. But once you conquer yourself, then there's the matter of everybody else that wants to conquer you. That's the next battlefield. And you're going to be ready for all those battlefields, because no matter where you end up, so long as you haven't given up on Allah, Allah will give you two treasures, hukman wa ilman. And this is, Sheikh Suhaib said this today, I couldn't agree more as we were discussing this ayah. Eventually Allah gave Yusuf alayhi salam governance or no? He gave him governance, he gave him redemption over his brothers, he gave him honor, he cleared his name from prison, he gave him all those things. But the most valuable thing Allah has given to Yusuf alayhi salam, that Allah says, and that's my reward for people who do their best. He didn't say that in the sense of the kingdom or the redemption and all of that. Actually, the ultimate reward has already been given to Yusuf alayhi salam. The ultimate reward is hukman wa ilman. The firmness of good decision making and the right kind of knowledge that keeps the firmness of decision making, Allah opens up the right kind of knowledge more and more and more. And that right knowledge gives him more better decision making, a stronger heart. That's the ultimate reward. He's already got the ultimate treasure, because kingdoms will come and go. Egypt will come and go. The crop will come and go. And when Yusuf alayhi salam is standing in front of Allah azza wa jal, the crop won't matter, the throne won't matter, the brothers won't, none of that will matter. The only thing that will matter is what he carried in his heart. إِلَّا مَنَتَ اللَّهَ بِقَلْبٍ سَلِيمٍ. That's the religion of Ibrahim alayhi salam. So let's put value on where value belongs. What is it that you and I are doing in our day that is taking our hearts away from Allah, that is the opposite of ihsan, and therefore our ability to make better decisions is getting weaker? And what is it that we can do to make better decisions, to be aware of Allah in everything that we say, in everything that we do, the integrity with which we live our lives, so that when we do that and we stand by the right thing, Allah will strengthen us to make better and better choices, which we believe for ourselves we're not strong enough to make. I'm not strong enough. That I'm not strong enough will start disappearing, because Allah will make you strong enough. Allah will give you that strength. May Allah Azza wa Jalla give every one of us the strength to live by the right thing, to live with ihsan every single day, so Allah will increase our hukum and our ilm in the best way for ourselves, our deen, and our dunya. Barakallahu li wa lakum fil Qur'an al-Hakim, wa nafa'ani wa iyaakum bil ayati wa dhikr al-Hakim. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuh. I'll fall this way today. My chair.